Hey, how's it going? I'm Troy Micheals, and I'm going to be playing some songs for you. The first one is called Heartbeat, and it's the newest one that I've written.
Just where did you go all this time? I've been missing you, friends. And I know that you're holding that distant me folding so long. I've been meaning to send you. The sound of my heartbeat is ticking so heavy right here. Most of you love me. But if you try to find me now, I've been waiting for you. And if you wanna heal me out, you can sense where I am. So don't go holding any fears of this lonely life. Please hold back the tears, cause now that I'm here, dear pals, how have you been? I've seen it enough to know where the fun stops in time and the weeping begins. There's not enough time in this world, so goodbye for now, and I'll see you again. Just know that it's not permanent, but a search for you, and we'll live it again. I'll say hey you hi, and it'll remind you of the time of way back when. It'll start and ignite, they can live fire inside within, and we'll live it again. But if you try to find me now, I've been waiting for you. And if you wanna feel me out, you can sense where I am. So don't go holding any fears of this lonely life. Please hold back the tears, cause now that I'm here, dear friends, how have you been?
Thank you. This next song is called Hey You, and ironically, it's in the same format. So, yeah.
You got lonely, I've been through the same old shit. You see, and I'll be here, shoulder and a knee. You know what, I think you need someone there. Little more company to let you know that you're not alone. And I've seen tears rolling off your cheeks, and I'm just here letting you know you mean everything to everyone around you. I just wanted you to let you know that we love you and we couldn't live without you. Let you know, without you. We will be so fucking lonely. Let you know that if you go, we couldn't fucking live without you. I know, let's all go to the mall and play hide and seek. I'll stand here, you'll try to find me after this. Let's catch another movie, let's watch a horror or a comedy. I don't care, as long as you're here with me. Invite some friends, maybe they wanna see. I just wanted you to let you know that we love you and we couldn't live without you. Let you know that without you, we would be so fucking lonely. Let you know that if you go, we couldn't fucking live without you. Let you know that we love you and we couldn't live without you. Let you know that without you, we would be so fucking lonely. Let you know that if you go, we couldn't fucking live without you.
Something. All right. Third song is going to be Wasted. It's about a bad friend, ex-friend. Under your covers, looking at the friend a new enemy discovered. Looking through the mirror, come what you said I fear. Losing more your memories and suffering impatiently. And on top of it, this French is burning. Crispy flaking, overtaking, just let it burn. See when it's close, that's so sad. You can blame me, always breaking my hands and running away. No, forget the peace of treaties you made, signing over and over again. I wanna waste of my day following you.
was a smile, only you can do. Counting steps for a checkmate I lose. Pulling out another trick on me, no total. We're setting up the stage of this pathologic fight to gore. The trigger, ready, suited, let's get to it. While I'm breathing, nothing's holding you back, so have at it. Wow, guess you weren't as close as a sad. You could blame me, always breaking my hands and running away. No, but yet the peace of treaties are made, signing over and over again. What a waste of my day following you. Cause I'm so sad. You can blame me, always breaking my hands and running away. No, but yet the peace treaties are made, signing over and over again. What a waste of my day following you.
Yeah, that was wasted. This next song is called Take Your Breath Away. Doesn't feel the same like the movies where we all just call it insane. Love for you. I fall asleep with eyes wide open inside. These dreams are killing me almost every night. Showing me life without you. Sometimes a forest, a desert, maybe a clue. A sandy beach at the lighthouse, but it's all the same to me. Without you, we could measure forever. And that's how long I wanna hold you. Now I'm luckier than ever, just to be in the same room to say I knew you. Now it's now or never. With me, so I can take your breath away. My eyes are glued to everywhere you move. It's involuntary, I don't have a shot of a chance with you. And that's why I'm so far far that I can talk to you. And even though, I'm so lonely inside, at least it's good to see your love at another side. Sometimes a forest, a desert, maybe blue, a sandy beach with the lighthouse, but it's all the same to me. Without you, if we could measure forever, then that's how long I'd wanna hold you. And I'm luckier than ever just to be in that same room to say I knew you. Now it's now or never, so I wanna ask you to stay with me so I can take your breath away.
Hello, welcome back to Color in the Shape of Sound Studios, StudioCast. We have a special guest. Want to introduce yourself?
Sure. I'm Troy Micheals, and I bang my hands on the guitar.
You just saw a set there. I actually met Troy at Guitar Center a few weeks ago, and he was just jamming on a guitar in the acoustic section, and we got to talking about guitars or music or whatever, and now he's here. Kevin, your wife made this. We have a list. This time we have a little bit of a list to try to stay on track.
That we do.
I don't know if you've really listened to much, but we're pretty ADD or whatever.
I'm super ADHD, so
we can't really stay on track. So.
And I'm sleep deprived again in a or in a podcast.
Yeah,
so,
sleep deprived clubbed.
Yeah, I'll probably be everywhere, but whatever.
All right, so. How did you get your start on music? How did you, what got you to where you are now?
That's a big question.
Yeah.
Where do I even begin? I'll start at 10 years old, because that's convenient, and that's when I started playing guitar. I came back to San Antonio after traveling for God knows how long, and I started living with my grandparents. They took me away from the foster system, because I was in another state, and that whole thing was crazy, but my grandpa bought me a Hohner acoustic guitar, which was awesome. But when when I was a kid, I didn't think it was awesome. I just thought, okay, just a big wooden piece of junk. So after this is gonna sound real dark, but after a few months, my dad passed away. I met him, and I was like, well, I wasn't impressed. And then my grandpa passed away, and I thought, well, I better learn guitar, because he did want me to learn guitar, and I feel kind of like a douchebag not doing that. So I learned to play guitar. I was playing mariachi, for one, in middle school, and I learned how to play the guitar through very Mexican chords, very, very Mexican songs.
That's kind of a inspirational, cool story that, you kind of learned for, your grandfather, and then now it came to be something that you super love and that your life is about. That's really cool.
Pretty crazy.
Yeah.
Well, I never thought I'd do that.
It's weird how things work out, right? You know, like you said, when you're younger, you were kind of lame.
Now
it's kind of your life, you know?
It's
interesting.
I'm not gonna lie, when I first saw the Hohner guitar, I just thought, you know, damn, why couldn't it be like a video game or something?
It could be Nintendo 64.
I was the same way when I was a kid and got my first guitar. I was like, oh, Liz Bites. Now I own three of them.
I was kind of like that. I wanted to play drums because my sister's boyfriend at the time played drums. I thought that was cool. And But my mom wanted me to play guitar because my great-grandpa did, and that was like a special thing to her and stuff. And she bought me a guitar, and I liked it. I thought it was cool, but like I wanted to play drums, so I kind of pushed it off. And like I guess I just thought it was gonna be like, this is gonna be hard, like, and I want to play drums. Learning drums and learning guitar are both gonna be hard. I don't want to start on guitar and then have to learn another hard thing. So I was like not really interested in it, but now I play both. So
I'm just imagining like the 10-year-old you or the 12-year-old, whatever, the little you.
I was in like sixth grade.
They're just like, here you go, like here's your first guitar. And you're like, yeah, you're trying to be excited, you're trying to act excited, but you're like, this is crazy.
Thanks, mom.
So this is a nice guitar, but you know, I mean, I've seen some drums. This is nice, but you know, I've seen some of those drums and
some of those drum things.
Yeah, those little things. They're called drums. Drum things. You pull it, Scott Pilgrim.
Yeah.
Drum thingies, and that's funny.
Well, Kevin, you're the list master. What's going on here? Your wife made it.
I know she made it. That doesn't mean I can read. we're doing the welcome.
We did that. Welcome. Welcome to CSS Studios.
Thank you.
Unless, you know, it's me, then it's CSSSS.
Yeah. We shot a video a while back, reviewing a mic, and then Kevin's like, welcome to CSSSSS. Oh, no.
And then I faded out because I realized I went way too long.
Okay. CSS Studios. He freaking works here and he doesn't know the name. But that's my bad. I made the name way too long. That's not a marketable name. Color in the Shape of Sound Studios, too much.
Well, I mean, it's nice when you have like a following. Like when you finally at that point where everybody knows you, it's like Color in the Sound Studios. It's like, you know.
Yeah. But now we're not. We're not there right now. We have like 25 subscribers.
But you can be.
But it's also kind of hard too when I want to reach out to metal bands. It's like, it's Color in the Shape of Sound.
like, oh, that sounds.
Hey guys, you sound pretty heavy. So that's a nice heavy sound you got there. Yeah. How would you like to come to my studio and make some really hard stuff?
All right, man.
In the Shape of Sound.
Yeah.
What kind of studio you guys got?
Well, see, we got a Color in the Shape of Sound.
Color in the what?
Color in the Shape of Sound.
It's somehow a metalhead got hooked up with a pop punk kid.
Yeah. Like we were talking about that earlier.
I picture Nathan Explosion just like, you're trying to pitch it to him, and he's like,
I don't think that I want to go to that studio. In fact, I want to punch the faces of everybody who works at that studio just because you told me. Like,
yeah. But,
where are you from?
Where am I from? That's a big question, too.
Oh, wow. Here we go. That's good. We like to talk. That's what this show's about. It's literally a talk.
Well, I was born here. Not here. I was born
right here in Color in the Shape of Sound Studios.
On this.
Yeah.
I was born right on this dance floor. It was ugly. It was the umbilical cord. It was. Yeah, I was squirming around like a fish. It was just everyone.
Blow up the dance floor.
That's how they wrote that.
That's where they got that name from.
Yeah, they got. Was it a band name?
It's a band.
Okay. Blow the dance floor.
And ironically, the singer of the Blood of on the Dance Floor was there. I was like, that's my name. But no, that's not how. But in all seriousness, though, I was born in San Antonio to a very, very Germanic, durable, weird-ass mom, and I had a total of four sisters on her side, different dads, and we had a stepfather, lived here for like the first 7 years of my life. Probably the first 12 of my sisters, my oldest sister. I won't say the names because I'll just keep it, you know, very. Anyways.
Yeah.
So, we went to Colorado. So that was a nice little trip, 980 miles. And we essentially just moved around a lot to a lot of different cities. I hardly was ever in school. I don't even remember being in school. Like, I vaguely remember walking home from like a institution for learning, higher learning for kids. Oh, yeah. You know, like it's fancy saying elementary school. But I vaguely remember doing that for a couple times, and then CPS got involved, and DHS, which is Department of Human Services, they got involved too because it was supposedly inhumane how we were, or not inhumane, but like it wasn't the conditions weren't for children, so.
Mm-hmm.
We were taken and brought to social services where I stayed for about a year and a half by myself. And I was the youngest kid in the home, so everybody else was 12 and older. So, you know.
Okay.
And then my grandparents found out where I was at, and my dad did, but he didn't wanna. He was doing his thing. So my grandpa and my grandma go to Colorado and pretty much talk to the courts, do the background check, and I come back with them, you know, in a month's time, around December of 2000. No, 99. Okay. December 1999. And then it came 2000 when I got, you get the picture.
How old are you now?
I'm 26.
Okay, man, I'm the baby here again.
I'm an old one.
Okay. I'm 22 and he's 20. He'll be 28 tomorrow.
28?
Good birthday, Kevin.
Thank you.
Okay, sorry.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday. alcohol. Anyways, I shouldn't be joking about alcohol. But it's good for you. So I come back, and my grandpa is like the wisest. It's sad because I didn't know him that well. I only knew him for a few months, if that. I remember. Like he would tell me some weird, really cool lessons that you can't like teach somebody how to say those lessons like that. Like this one time, my grandma was out doing errands and he was like, "Hey Troy, you want to go in the backyard and make holes?" And I was like, "Yeah." So we get up and we go in the backyard and he handed me this like stick. I think it's a shovel, but he just hands me one end of something. Yeah. I take it and I'm about to do it and I flip it and then I see it's a mop and I'm like, and I'm processing this. My brain doesn't know how to interpret this. I'm like, how does he want me to? I'm seriously thinking about how he wants me to make holes in the mop. Like, is this some new type of like method of teaching kids or something? Like, I don't. And then he starts laughing like the love guru, the old man, and he's like, and then he just tells me like, Troy, you gotta use your eyes. You know, somebody can give you $5 and say, hey, here's your 50. Oh, you can just take it and you know, you're out $45. And I'm like, wow, that's some serious, you know.
Yeah. So that's kind of cool. That's a good story, man. That's cool.
Yeah.
Well, what happened? What
after that?
Yeah.
I stayed in San Antonio for most of that time up till 18, but I did go to Florida for a little bit, and I did go back to Colorado when I got older, and I started getting more into music. I met this guy Brad Bach, who was he had a full time job as like an insurance something. But he also like would manage artists, although that wouldn't really pay the bills, that would still fulfill as part of his life. And the artists that he would manage were initially they just needed like recording time and promo and maybe just basic stuff that you know an artist needs to get off the ground. And the artists themselves had, you know, full lives and they were, you know, they progressed, and he was just kind of like there to record them. It was basically like a studio.
Similar to what we're doing.
Yeah, similar like that. And he would just help them along, and he would keep track of them too. Like they would keep in touch. It wasn't like a dead, like, all right, I finished your album, bye. Like, it was a very like, hey, how's it going?
It becomes a friendship type of thing, yeah.
Yeah, and
that's how we are here. Like, all of the people we record and all the artists we still keep in contact with, and whenever they, you know, have new stuff coming out, we always promote it on our Facebook and stuff like that. And
yeah.
Try to keep in touch.
So that's really awesome. And Brad introduced me to Alan, who had, like, he owned the studio, and I basically was just, I was just a paid artist. I would help to, like let's say vocalists came in and they had lyrics but they didn't have music. And surprisingly enough, you get a lot of those. And I would write, you know, like riffs to it. I would write music, whether it be guitar, maybe a little ukulele.
Just like a studio guitar.
Whatever it was. Maybe just, you know, stuff like that. We'd make up. was it too loud for the mic? No, we're good. But, you know, I would create stuff for vocalists or artists, and, you know, that was kind of my thing, and I would be paid per song, if like a band came in and like they obviously had the music, so I didn't need to do anything. I would just help out with like running the lines, making sure that everything was connected okay. I would do some office work too, like whenever we check inventory, because they did do like merchandise and CDs. They'd keep track everything that they had produced. They would always have like a UPC code.
Yeah.
And you know, they would just check how much stock came in, how much stock went out, you know, how many units were sold, units is like CDs and stuff. And I learned a lot of stuff through them.
Business work kind of thing.
And it sucked because I hated every minute of it. But
really?
It did me good though. It was so boring and annoying.
Was that kind of your first introduction to that real music business scene?
Yeah.
That was pretty cool.
Yeah, before I didn't know, I was like, I want to be an artist. And then I learned all this and I'm like, damn, this sucks.
This is a real job. This isn't just playing music. Yeah. There's a lot behind it, you know?
A lot of people don't realize that either.
Yeah, that's true. Especially when we have like a lot of people come into the studio.
Mm-hmm.
They don't realize they're like, why am I paying so much money for this when we're a lot cheaper than a lot of other studios, and like they're allowed to use any of our gear or, you know, any amps or what, and like we're like, well, why pay by the hour? Well, like, that's if you don't have your, you know, your shit together and you're, you know, wasting our time, then, you know, doing $100 a song can end up really putting us back, you know, when we could have other bands coming in and stuff, you know.
Brad had a saying, and I still think that that's true to this day. Like, I'm also working on a movie project. Not me. Okay. Like, I'm my friend started this movie project, and it's called, I can't say the name of it, disclosure. But he wanted me to be the program director, which pretty much means I have to manage everybody's jobs. And,
yeah.
You know, and I respect everyone's time. I don't want to be saying things twice because that just wastes my time, wastes your time, etc.
Yeah.
And Brad would always say, for you don't want to waste people's time. Mm-hmm. So whether you're an engineer or you're an artist or you're a lawyer or you're whoever you are, mm-hmm. when you're coming to an establishment, like an artist coming to a label, or I'm sorry, a studio,
yeah.
and you're expecting to record your album, your single, whatever it is,
mm-hmm.
you know, you should have your stuff in line. You should understand that your time, like you guys as engineers, you have a lot on your plate. You have to manage your schedule. You have to make sure that the right, you know, the right edits went to the right pieces of music.
Exactly.
And that you can afford to do these things for artists. And these artists have to understand that the more time they spend in your studios, the more time that
they're given.
Yes, exactly. Because time is money. And you need to, I want to respect everybody's time as they should respect mine.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
What about something we usually get into on these podcasts are gear. Mm-hmm. Like I was telling you earlier, Kevin and I are kind of gear whores, and we're just a little bit.
Especially if you look at the drum stuff.
Yeah, I know.
That's Kevin's wall. That's my wall.
In case you guys don't know, there's a big wall just filled with drums, just from top to bottom.
We're actually planning on doing a studio tour here pretty soon. I'm waiting on picking up a couple of patch bays to put in the tracking room, and then I want to do a studio tour.
It looks
all people really see in the podcast are kind of just the drums and a little bit of the back wall and the sides and stuff.
Yeah.
There are a couple pieces of gear over there, though, that I'm not allowed to touch.
Yeah. Kevin is a heavy hitter.
Let me guess. It's the tom. I mean, not the tom. The snare and a zildjian.
Well, it's certain cymbals. It's actually a Sabian cymbal.
Sabian, okay.
Anything that is pretty much not these pitch blacks. These black cymbals.
Yeah.
Are like super heavy duty metal cymbals.
Yeah.
Kevin's a dick. He breaks all
his shit. Here's the thing. If you look at the set, I have a 22-inch ride. This is my minus. There's a snare over there that I actually use that's not on the kit right now. I use that
We have a special
blackish chrome one.
Kevin that has three layers.
How hard do you hit that thing? Like,
I'll show you after the podcast.
Yeah,
I play a 22-inch heavy ride, a 22-inch crash ride, or an 18-inch crash ride, and then I have a 20-inch ride over there.
That he uses for a crash.
That I use as a crash. And then way in the back, there's a little, like, 16-inch fast crash.
I didn't
crash.
Even know you could use a ride for a crash. It's so... Like, how do you even...
I play thick sticks as well.
Yeah,
do you break your sticks every time you play? Like, bam!
He's
a new one.
He's taken a lot of time and effort finding sticks that work for him. He's found two sets. The one that we both use are the... Do you know who Travis Barker is?
I know who Travis Park. I mean, I know I've heard of him.
He's a drummer for Blink-182.
Okay,
and,
that's fine.
He does all kinds of side projects, but we found he has a pro stick that is like a freaking tree trunk, and it's actually based off of a marching snake.
Oh my god!
Yeah, you can see
Travis Barker.
Okay, these are fine, but
these are my main sticks.
Those are Kevin's sticks. Yeah,
God.
We'll see here. The thing is. I used to play metal and like metal and punk, and I was playing with guys that would bring in Marshall stacks.
Yeah.
So I've got to.
He's got
to
keep.
I got really used to having to compete with guitarists.
And they didn't and mic bassist. The drums because Kevin was a punk that played in crappy venues and stuff.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. No kidding.
Yeah, I was lucky. Like mainly the only thing that I'd ever get kicked or mic'd was like a kick. So yeah, I'm. Those are my behemoths. I actually own a pair that I speed train with that are even thicker, but I don't bring them here.
Now, how thick are you talking? Are you talking about like?
Have you ever seen them? Okay, well, here, basically, I have a set that's about that big.
Okay,
it's like a quarter.
All right.
Yeah,
pretty big. That's
probably, really probably like a 3/4-inch stick or something. It's a Marshall stick.
Wow.
Yeah,
it's a Marshall.
There's still some room there if that's if that's a quarter's length.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. He's not allowed to bring it. He doesn't even. I don't let him step foot in the studio with
those are,
sticks.
Yeah. And on top of that, they're a aluminum grip.
With they're already shaft. Thick. Are you trying to kill the drums or?
Yes.
They're real heavy. So
I had to get him a snare head that is freaking 3 layers thick to just don't so it doesn't put a hole in or soup bowl them out.
Yeah.
See, we were spending so much on heads.
Do you know anything about drum heads or drum tech stuff?
You know what? I wish I could answer that and say yes, but I'm just going to be honest.
I'll basically put it this way. It sounds like you've hung out in studios.
Yeah.
You know bass drum heads are typically pretty thick.
Yeah.
That's how thick my toms are.
What?
Yeah.
No!
I use Aquarian Force Tins, and
they're pretty
thick.
How do you even get sound out of that? Like, it doesn't just, like, how do you not get up? Or... Like,
because he hits so hard.
I get a good sound out
of it. I can only imagine it's like,
poof. Yeah, we'll give you a demo.
We'll show you after the podcast.
This is that ADHD kicking in.
Yeah. We need to focus. We need to focus here. Okay.
But yeah, no, we didn't. Did we even talk about your gear? I said, yeah, so what kind of gear are you using?
We talked about how we're gear whores.
Yeah.
Okay, well, Kevin.
What's your main acoustic setup? What kind of guitar are you
using? So,
is that you today?
Yeah, currently I'm playing a Mitchell. But I have been known to play Alvarez's, Yamaha's.
I got Alvarez inside the house.
Oh man, I loved Alvarez's. Yeah. I gave mine away. Not gave it. I sold it because back then, weed's a hell of a drug.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, you can say it.
Boy. Okay, well, back then, not now, but back then, weed was a hell of a drug. And I had to let it go. But nowadays I play Mitchells. I'm looking into getting a new Yamaha. I'm still open for suggestions for acoustic guitars.
Ibanez put out. What are you doing, Ken?
I was just messing with my wife. Eastman?
Yeah, that's
I have it. Washburns. Oh, I had a Washburn. I forgot about that.
I actually have. It's at home. It's like it's my baby. I don't let anyone play it unless it's like I. Fully trust them. Yeah.
Because you told me that I don't want to play the guitar because I want to keep it pure.
There's a guitar boutique in San Antonio called Redbone. And they sell Eastman guitars. It's, I think the only
Wait
shop
a minute.
I know of.
Is that hang on. Did the guy is it near downtown? And
it's on Broadway. It's got Beatles memorabilia everywhere.
Yeah, it has like, you know, like the Abbey Road?
Yeah.
It's got like that and out front.
Okay, so that's not the same place. I'm thinking of another place that I forgot what it's called, but the guy that owns that works at Sam Ash, or he worked at Sam Ash.
Yeah.
And he had bought a place that was close to like going down, like the Blue Star? The Blue Star?
Yeah,
studios.
Yeah, I know what that is.
Going down that street, and then like it steers off in like two ways, and
okay, yeah.
I think you take the... No, you go left. You go left, and you keep going down the street, and then you see, like, there's a fish restaurant thing, and then there's, like, these apartment complexes, and...
Is that their old shop? Because they just sold one.
No, they had a shop in the quarry, and their new shop is probably a mile south of 410 on Broadway.
Okay.
But, no...
You have to go to Guitar Center, coming from downtown, right?
Well, they moved locations, but... They, no, I play in Eastman, and it's a... People think kind of badly because it's a Chinese-made guitars. However, though, they're like it's a small like boutique company that's been around for over 100 years.
Well, if the quality is good, then it shouldn't matter.
Yeah, lot of people hear that though, and they're like, oh, they're probably, like you know Chinese squires
they're
and that.
Idiots.
But
ignorant
these things,
say whatever.
Like this is a $600 just straight acoustic, and throw a set of elixirs on that thing.
Yeah, it sounds and great. And the action is close to an electric. It really is a great guitar.
Oh my god, wait, you need to write this down because I'm going to look at that guitar.
Yeah, it's...
I've been looking for something because that's a nice guitar, don't be wrong, just the strings are super old. Yeah. And I need to get a new...
Yeah, that Fender, that's a cheap guitar. That's my...
that one too.
Tim Armstrong guitar.
It's like a $300 acoustic.
It's like $500, I think.
No, it's like... Maybe over three.
I think I got it.
For if five, it's a Fender, I'd believe five. It could be like $499 or something.
I think when you can look it up. When I got it, I'm pretty sure it was like $500, but it's more of a like fast strumming guitar type of thing, and like you could do like a Johnny Cash type of thing, but it's not really playing real fast and stuff. Yeah.
$350.
Okay.
See my Eastman, I play a lot of like. Fast like folk stuff on it. That's
yeah.
It's like my favorite. But yeah, like I play an Eastman AC222, and oh yeah, I think it's a little bit. It's definitely a bigger body than the Hellcat, but it's got like a nice.
It's thinner than my Johnson though, right?
Or is it about to basically?
Are you talking about that thin one, the already thin one that you showed me?
No. That's an electric.
Oh, okay, I was like,
This guitar though, like if it's just you playing, it's. Kind of like a Martin in a sense, where it's just got a nice full.
It's really warm. It's tone. It's great.
Like it's good if it's just a single person.
I used to have a Martin too, and I forgot about that.
I am one of the only people, but I'm not a Martin fan. Am I gonna get shot right now?
No, I liked it. Yeah. I really miss my Martin.
I'm a big Taylor guy. I love.
We'll
Taylors.
See. Okay, here. To me, this is exactly where I stand on this. Taylor is great if you're playing in a band and you need that little bit of. Cut okay, to get through like the Curly Wolf, he's endorsed by Taylor and the Taylor sounds really good with them but somebody like him, Troy, right?
Yeah, Troy.
Sorry,
yeah.
Horrible.
No, you're good. I need to ask you guys' names too.
Kevin Johnny.
So but like for what Troy does, I think a Martin would go better.
Yeah,
especially with how his voice is.
Yeah,
I think most
I love my Martin when I had
would
it.
Go better. And they have a sick Martin SMS right now.
Really?
It's a black body with an ebony neck and
I
an
saw
ebony
that.
Fretboard.
I saw one.
Okay, I've actually seen that one too. I haven't been to Samash since like 3 months. No, not even. It was like 2 months ago. But I've seen that guitar though.
I think I saw that at Guitar Center. They have one now.
I was like,
in like
I
nice.
Truly.
So I haven't seen it in Guitar Center.
No, I saw maybe.
But then again, I didn't go. You might. Did you see it in the booth on the right, not the left one, but like the.
No, I saw on the left where all the nice, really expensive guitars are.
Okay, I didn't pay attention.
Sorry, I won't go into Guitar Center.
He doesn't. No. Yeah, he doesn't do that anymore.
I go to Sam Ash, but that's because I got buddies that work in the drum department. So.
Gotcha.
Shout out to Skippy and.
Drumbo.
Drumbo, yeah. We our other buddy who also works here, Jeremy Zapatu, has done his albums coming out. Yeah. Shout out to Jeremy's album coming out in 2 months. But anyway, we work downtown at First Baptist Church doing sound and stuff. But we'll have these weird work schedules where we'll have like 2 hours off in the middle of the day. So we'll just go hang out at Sam Ash Guitar Center or like pawn shops and stuff and just look at gear. That's so cool. We're down there all the time. I met you, that's what we were doing. We were on break.
Oh man. Yeah. That sounds like an awesome job. Like, you guys just...
It's all right. We do a lot of manual labor as well, though, which I didn't sign up for, but it is what it is.
Hey, your manual labor is not like what I got to do, though.
Okay, yeah, Kevin literally is a manual labor job. He picks up boxes.
I'm straight up blue collar.
Well, did you choose that, or did they say, well, this guy looks pretty burly. Hey, can you lift a few pounds over your head?
I prefer... I can't sit in an office.
Yeah.
I'm too... Like, you can ask my wife, I can't even sit through a movie. Like, I don't know the last time I watched, like, a full movie and not gotten up.
Yeah.
I just gotta move. That's why drums are great for me.
Yeah.
You know what? I've noticed I haven't gone to the movies that much either. Like, I went to go see Logan. Not impressed, by the way.
Are you kidding me? I was just gonna say, so good. I was just
telling
you gotta
see it. Well, okay, not for me. Not. Oh, wait. Yeah.
It's
you
so
it.
Good, guys.
It's so good.
It's so super serial.
I'm so serial.
It's so good.
I'm serial.
Are you sure, Al Gore? I'm super, super serial.
Don't make me slap you.
I'm just a serial as member pig, okay?
Member pig.
It's real. But, yeah, no, I mean, I liked... Okay, so Logan was a good concept. I didn't like how at the very end, like,
Spoilers.
Oh, I can't do any.
Okay. You can. I said spoilers now, so spoilers.
Okay, so spoilers. Logan dies, and fact check. He doesn't come back. He just straight up stays under a shit ton of rocks, and it's like the girl has some sense of respect at the end of the movie when he finally dies. That's what gets me is like the whole movie. She hates his ass. She just and then she kind of gains a little bit of trust when like the fake Logan's trying to kill everybody. He's like no, and he's like you know.
Yeah.
But then that whole goes out the window because he's like, I'm leaving. And she's like, well, fuck you too then.
Yeah.
In Spanish. Yeah.
Even though she can speak English, she's like, you speak English?
Yeah, she speaks and that gets me too. She speaks English and Spanish, but she chooses to only speak Spanish for like 3/4 of the movie. And then she finally says, you know you're going to die, right? Like, and then you're like, she can talk?
Bitch, please.
I
did like that. I was really impressed. I'm impressed with 2016 and 17 movies altogether. I don't know.
I will say that too.
Are you a Star Wars fan?
Yeah.
Okay, because Rogue One and The Force Awakens.
Oh my god, guys! Let me tell you about Star Wars right now. It's so exciting.
You know what, Kevin?
That's so amazing.
This podcast got its start because we wanted to do a nerd podcast.
Oh.
So it turned into this just because
I've got to ask. What was the first vision of
this?
All of this?
Okay, well, what happened was, I told you my buddy and I work at that church, and we have a lot of time off, and a lot of BS kind of happens at that job.
Yeah.
I don't want to get into anything, I don't want to call anybody out or anything, but it's just there's a lot of negativity there, and we have a lot of like time off and stuff, which is weird because of church, but it happens, you know? And just to pass the time, and not to cope, like, it's not like they abuse us or anything, but we're just
that sounds like they abuse you.
Just to keep morale high or whatever between the two of us, we just joke around constantly, and it's gotten real bad. Like we come up with these crazy scenarios, like what if this happened, and like it's gotten so bad. This guy that we work with, normal guy, never had a problem with him. He just works, you know, desk job, whatever. We came up with a scenario that he has a past life that he was a clown, and he just. His name is Boppo. We gave him an entire story, background, the year he was born. It's really bad.
This sounds like D&D level. Like you just create an entire alternative life for people. Like
yes, that's what we do.
Well, dude, that's like when Fmir or Co see somebody like pulled over on the side of the road with like the hood popped up or something. I'll just start going off, and it's like. Well, I don't know what happened to the car. It just stopped working. I don't know why. Yeah. It's just, it ain't running.
Damn, please. Every time you want to get oil change, you just keep saying, I'm going to change it myself.
Yeah.
Never go around to it.
This is your milestone puff. It'll be number 1,000.
That's not all today. That's since I
know. It's since you've had it. It's like a car.
No, not since I've had it. You can reset it.
Well, then it's your milestone either way.
Okay, here we go. One more
He's
pop.
Trying to be happy. Just be happy. Don't ruin his moment. Let him keep it.
He okay, needs there you
it.
Go.
It's like when I get
Were you keeping
car.
Track of that this whole time?
It was entertaining.
Okay. No, but
like
anyway.
I said, I'm tired and ADD.
Anyway, so we have this like just this so stupid stories. It gets to where it's not even funny. Like it's funny to us just because we're coming up with these weird scenarios.
I can
like,
dig that.
If you're you know talking to somebody like, listen to this awesome joke. This guy, he's a clown. Like, okay, that's not funny. But so we thought we would make a podcast called Two Guys That Are Not High. No, we don't really smoke or anything, but like it's so stupid. It just sounds like
it sounds
these guys
like
gotta
high,
be high.
Not high.
Yeah, so we wanted to call it Two Guys That Are Not High.
You know what?
And you remember Fuel TV?
Yes. And I remember Fuel TV.
They used to have this show called The Daily Habit.
Back before it was all MMA.
Yeah, before it was all MMA. They used to have skating and BMX and all that on it.
I remember that. Tony Hawk was like a big thing. Everybody was just like, oh
yeah,
my God.
They had that Daily Habit show. And they had the show was where they have bands come on and they interview them kind of and they play a small set. So I was like, I want to do that. That's really
like,
cool.
Oh, why don't you do that? That'd be
well, that's what this is. That's like,
oh,
shit. You know, you
but go, you're doing it right now.
Oh,
we're on
we
it.
Okay. We got to talk about marketing after this because that's a bunch of nobody needs to hear that.
Yeah, but,
and we both skate.
Yeah, we both grew up skating.
You could make a
skate
big,
and BMX.
Like, you don't even know how much content you have for people to like take in. And
yeah,
so,
that's what we're trying to really go for. And it's also a really good way for to get the studio's name out because, you know, you're going to go take this and share it. It's like, hey, check out the set I did and a little bit about me. And they're going to check it out and thus checking out more local bands. So when they see our channel, they see us and they'll maybe subscribe to our channel or whatever. And then they'll say, oh, look at this other band they did. I'll check that. It looks similar. And like it'll turn other people onto the other bands. And also, you know, when someone, like we just did a band called 40% Dolomite, they have a pretty good following locally.
They are so good.
They are so good. Shout out to G, you're a boss, man. No, but, you know, maybe some of their fans will listen, they'll listen and they'll see your set and be like, check this out. And then, you know, just kind of spreading marketing and promotion, really, you know. It's a win-win-win-win situation.
That definitely helps. Also, street teams are really awesome, too.
Okay,
I'm not gonna, I'll talk to you guys after that, because there's some stuff that, like, you get to take this to a whole new level. But anyways.
That's what we're going for. We like I said, we just started, like, maybe a year ago. We started doing, you're only like the fourth or fifth like artist we've had, so we've had a couple of guys like engineers come in and talk and stuff, but this is kind of, the whole podcast thing is really new. We're mostly, okay, we're at 32 minutes. We gotta wrap this up in a little bit. Anyway, sorry.
No, you're good.
A bunch of guys.
I got a text from the.
from the wife in there. No, not my wife, Kevin's wife.
My wife.
My girl's not here. Anyway.
She keeps us on track.
Well, that's good.
Well, that's what you need a woman for.
I'm dating my ex-bandmate, Samantha.
No, but we're really just trying to promote ourselves really right now. That's why we're doing these. Like, you can come on for free and to promote yourself. And a lot of bands are like in high school still and stuff. They can't afford to do recordings. So if you want, you don't have to, but you can buy. If you're a solo artist, it's 25. And if you're a full band, it's 50. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you got five guys in a band, 50 is not, that's not bad.
No, it's nothing. That's like less than
10 bucks a piece. Yeah. You know?
But if you do gangster rap, it's 10 grand.
God damn it, gangster raps.
I haven't had any hip hop artists in here, but I'm not opposed to it. I mix it and stuff.
I'm actually trying to get one in. Tried getting one in. Yeah.
I've actually helped. Go ahead.
I've actually surprised people. Because I'll introduce myself. I'm like, hey, I'm Kevin Mark. I work at a local recording studio. But it'll throw them off because it's a show with like 10 people at it.
Yeah.
And then, y'all are good. Exactly, and they're like,
admissions.
Oh, whoa, wait, what? Hey, you never know who you're going to meet at a show, man.
Exactly. Yeah. I've always said
just grind,
that. You know?
Dude.
We'll go out and pass out business cards. They're just like when I saw you, I was like, okay, you have a business card, you know?
Yeah, I still have it.
Yeah, I'm just, you know, I saw you jamming and heard. You were kind of barely singing and stuff. I was like, okay, that is pretty good. And we got talking about guitars and stuff. So it's
their business card Rocio made for me.
I saw them. His are coming out. I got those made maybe, I don't know, a few, like maybe 5 months ago or so. And that's kind of how I started promoting and stuff. But,
earlier, but I forgot.
Oh man, that's the worst. It's gonna bother you for the rest of the day if you don't think of it.
Oh no. Well, because I want to talk about the Uber incident, but then there was something before that.
That's the Kevin cards Monk. My wife designed.
That's the front.
That's the front of it.
That's cool. And then the back.
White on like a white, and then the back is a sound wave. She's nice. A graphic designer, so she makes lots of stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's kind of our unofficial graphic designer. She's we have bands and stuff come in and they need cover art or whatever, or maybe banner or something. We'll throw the work to her. I do a little bit. I did a cover art for my buddy's album that's coming out real soon, Jeremy's, and it took me like 2 days to make the front, back, and the CD. And like for Rocio, she can knock that in like 2 hours.
2 hours,
you
probably.
say 2 days, but how many hours is that?
Gosh, I don't know. I was in here for like hours, like a long time. Like
1/6, less than 12?
Probably like 12 hours.
12? Damn.
Yeah.
Damn.
It's literally just like a picture of text on it.
You spent 12 hours on text?
Well, I mean,
Did you at least add color to it? Or?
Yes. And I had to figure out, like, I don't know anything about Photoshop. I have it.
That explains it.
Yeah.
It's dark white.
It took me the longest time to get like the purport. I had to like look up the proportion, do a lot of research and everything, and like
I had to make sure that
I had to figure out how to like get like the shape of the CD and the hole in the middle. That took me for like 2 hours.
I could not find
tutorials on it.
I picture you just sitting there like, okay, this shade of white needs to be eggshell and this needs to be just like straight up vanilla white, and I swear to God, if it isn't vanilla white, then someone's gonna be held accountable.
It was pretty bad, but yeah, I've really been doing more Well, my obviously main thing is the audio. I'm an audio engineer. Mm-hmm. Kevin and I both graduated from AEI, and that's our thing. But I've been branching out and doing videography, so trying that out.
Good.
I'll show you my girlfriend's channel. Shout out to Ali O'Brien. She has a channel if you like dance. Anyway, I'll show you some, you know, start of my videography career, I guess. Not really career, just it's more of a hobby, and I'm helping her out.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
If you ever need a drummer too for any of your recordings, I'm a session drummer here.
Yeah.
I kind of do need a drummer.
He's your man. Look at
him. Oh, you know
I'm
what?
I'm a session dude.
I have, oh man, I actually have like a few songs that I wanted to add drums to, but I don't know, just I never found a drummer to like do anything with, or even to, even if I have to like re-record them, I've just
yeah,
I never
yeah.
found anybody to like.
Well, he does everything from jazz to metal to like hip hop, like.
Big Bad Voodoo Daddy to Bowling for Soup.
Whoa,
to,
Black Betty, Bam Bam. Whoa, Black Betty.
Ambulance!
Yeah.
You see that video?
To the scene. Agony scene.
Yeah.
Like.
What does the fox say? Yeah, I saw that video. I saw when it was before it was famous.
I saw that before it was a meme.
I did actually. I like, because my friends, I have friends who work in like entertainment news. Like
okay,
like
yeah.
like one of them lives near New York and she works for the Ithaca or something, and then
okay.
I have another friend who works for Worldwide Metal News or something. It's a joke news, but like
okay,
it's still
yeah.
entertaining. It's like alternative press, but not as big. It's like
okay,
maybe
yeah,
half
yeah.
the size.
Yeah.
And he sent me a video of it, and he was like, hey, check this out, and it was that stupid song. I was like, dee, 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 dee. And I'm just like, yeah, and I'm listening to it, and I'm like, what the fuck is this? Did you seriously make this as a joke and then send it to me? He's like, no, that's the actual
that's an actual
song off
yeah.
of their album. And I'm like, you're lying. And he's
yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
No, it is. But
that's funny. Okay, this has been really eating at me. Before, when we were setting up for the podcast, Troy was telling us he used to be an Uber driver.
I keep clicking this pin in the... I can't stop. I keep clicking it in
here,
the pin.
Here, Kevin, here. Just take this. Just do it. Here.
Thank you.
He's got a fidget toy now.
I'm a drummer. I can't sit still, man.
We, cool. Quit it. Don't hit the freaking
microphone. I didn't mean to.
Jeez,
it's cool.
It.
I got it.
Yes, Muller.
Troy,
yes.
You used to be an Uber driver, and
yeah.
you had me on the edge of my seat. And I wanted to save it for the podcast, so let's hear it.
Oh man, so I have some stories. I have some real shit that has happened in Uber. I won't disclose names because privacy. But I will say that. All right, so I picked up these two lawyers. This happened last year, sometime around like August. And I picked up these two lawyers from
the It was the dude, bar. Wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. So there's two really old, like, picture 5'4", really kind of, like, skinny Mexican-looking
yeah.
older guys. You know,
yeah.
they're lawyers, and they're doing
suits
thing.
And stuff.
Yeah, so they go back home. Well, I drop off his friend, and while we're going to his place, because his house was, like, another 8 miles,
yeah.
we, like, you started talking... He started talking more, like, about what his job. He's like, oh, yeah, I talk to children who have been in, like, bad situations. And I think, okay, that's a cool, you
yeah,
know,
because
yeah. I'm going for counseling, so,
yeah.
you know.
Really,
yeah, I'm like, that's cool.
Yeah.
Now, what got me was it started getting a lot creepier in the conversation because he started asking me personal questions that...
He was trying to counsel you as your as.
Yes, that's what was creepy about it was he was giving the same tone that normally counselors or litigators
yeah.
do for kids, but like with me,
yeah.
and he asked me the same type of questions. Like in my head, I'm picturing him talking like this to kids and like
yeah.
how messed up it is and how do I report this guy? You know, like. But
yeah,
anyways,
he pulls up a bear. He's like, "So where did she touch you?"
Yeah, like there's just creepy stuff. Like he'd say, "Oh, well, are you a virgin?" This. Oh, you know. Or he's asked stuff like, have you ever been molested when you were a kid? I sense that, this, and, oh, you know, I mean,
yeah.
I heard that statistics say that kids who get molested by the same gender
become Uber drivers.
Or something.
No.
Or something really
yeah.
dumb and specific, and I'm, like, the whole time, I'm just like, I want to get to this guy's house and just
so
get the fuck out.
Yeah.
And then he starts talking about how he's an exhibitionist, and he likes... people to watch him as he strips naked.
What?
And I'm telling you, this is the weirdest ride.
He, I could somehow, get naked right now if that makes you feel more comfortable.
No, somehow.
Johnny, do not.
Somehow, like, the conversation, in those 8 miles, those 12 minutes, like, it was the longest conversation I'd ever had in 12 yeah. minutes, because it felt like hours. It was like, it would not end. I wanted it to just be over.
You're driving, you all get like, you hit every red light and you're stuck in traffic.
Basically, and I could not, like, it was so long. And then by the end of the ride, here's the creepiest part. He's like, before we get to his house, like, it's about a minute or so.
Yeah.
He's like, somehow he brings up daddy. He brings up like the dad thing. He's like, yeah. Oh, you need a daddy? I can be your daddy. You want me to be your daddy? I will be your daddy. Like, he's
I
saying,
will never call you daddy.
Like, I shit you not. That is exact. He's just like, do you want me to be your daddy? I'll be your daddy. Yeah, I'll be your daddy. Gosh. Do you want me to? And then we get to his house, and then he's like, okay, well, I'm going to go in my backyard, and I'm an exhibitionist again, and I'm going to strip naked, and I'm going to take a piss outside. You can come and watch me if you want. And I was like, no, I'm good.
Oh, my phone's ringing. I gotta go.
Oh, no, another notification. Oh, that's there's nothing on your phone. Yeah. Oh, it's that new app. It doesn't show anything. I have to click it or else. Yeah. No, I didn't pull any. I was just like, no, I'm good. I'm just gonna
trying to cut down on public nudity.
Yeah, I have to get home because this. I just made up some bullshit.
I would honestly have been like, you know what? Don't even pay me. Just get out.
It took like, yeah, it took some time. No, like. They add better.
Did he tip you? Or does it you?
No, he didn't. I was thinking about that. No.
He thought that your tip was him offering to, you know, you watch him pee. Like,
I don't think that doesn't sound appealing. That just doesn't sound like, I don't wake up one day and say, I hope I get to watch somebody pee outside as a tip, because that's just how.
Man, that's worth more than money. That, you know, I don't need to eat this week. I just want to see someone take a pee out back.
Seriously, like, it was the weirdest crap ever. And like, he gets out, and like, I one star that asshole, because like, no. If I could have zero starred him, I would have, but they don't give you that option.
Yeah.
Literally, after that, I turned off the app, I went straight home, and have you ever seen those movies where, like, the dude has the same straight face, he's just like, and like, he's going home in the car, and then it shows him in the shower, and then it shows him, like,
it's just like, it's the same thing.
The same face, but like, he's just doing different actions, he's just like, trying to process, like,
What happened?
Like, you're trying to process, like, oh my god, did that actually, like, you have pre-PTSD symptoms, and you're just, like, trying to cope. Your brain's coping with it, like, oh my god, what happened?
That happened
for the whole day, that night, the next day, and then after, like, the morning, I woke up and I was like,
did that guy really?
Holy shit, I need to tell my friend. I call Ed, and I'm like, hey, man, I got some shit to tell you that you're gonna want to hear, because this, like, just get the fuck over here. I gotta tell you something. And then basically I just started telling my friends about it. And
then you tried to start a podcast, but your friend denied the world from that story. But I'm here with CSS Studios to give the world this story.
The world needs to know.
Oh, yes.
The world must know. How many licks does it take to get to the center of a titty pop? All right. So that was one story.
I'm oddly content with this hand spinner.
I told you, Kevin, I bought this little...
Me too. It's actually very pleasing to like watch
you, it spin. Yeah, it's like they have these fidget toys for people listening. It's just like skateboard bearings, three of them out kind of star shaped, and then one in the middle. And you just spin it, and it's oddly satisfying.
Yeah, give it a whirl.
Yeah, just go ahead, Troy. Just try it out. Just
oh my god.
Now do this a little bit. Kind of go back and forth. You get like a weird. Like
gyroscopic.
Yeah.
Oh, this is really fulfilling. How much was this?
Okay, it was an impulse purchase.
This is a sore subject for him.
It was an impulse purchase. I
bring a discount.
No, I didn't steal it. I was at the vape shop and they had them. I'll buy one. And it was $12. I spent $12 on a piece of plastic and three skateboard bearings.
Although you can go on Amazon and get that for $1.
Yeah.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah, you can buy them for like $1 and you can get like a little bit better one for like $3, but you know what? Whatever. I'll go up to a restaurant if my girlfriend puts in her purse, and when I'm like at the table, like, oh, ketchup or salt pepper, I'll be messing with shit, and she just takes it and then hands it to me and goes, okay, there you go, babe. Yeah. That is
one hell of a story.
Yeah, that's crazy. But you know what the sad thing lawyer. Is?
Yeah.
I believe it, man. The world, like, for a while, I worked at a storage facility for a while, right when I got out of high school. And if you think about it, people that need storage are a lot of people that are moving or they're getting evicted or something, and they're kind of at the worst point in their life. And I just heard some crazy stories. I think the weirdest thing that ever happened to me was this chick and two guys came, and they had a U-Haul truck full of just their belongings.
Dildos.
Yeah, it was full of dildos. No, they just whatever was their stuff, and they were trying to get storage, and they were, you know, asking me about prices and stuff, and I told them, and they're like, these prices are ridiculous. I need something better. Can you give me a better deal? And I was like, I just work here. I don't make the prices. This is what it is, you know? And then she was like, come on, just give me a deal or whatever. And I was like, I'm sorry, I can't. I just work here. And then so they went out, and they were standing outside the office, like outside, and they were just talking. And the girl came in, and she goes, so, are you by any chance gay? I was like, no, not a fan of the sausage. Never played for the other team. And she,
I don't play that game, Missy.
And she was like, are you sure? And I was like,
Pretty sure.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure.
Pretty sure I've never wanted to try.
Yeah, I've never had that desire. Nope, pretty sure. And she's like,
I don't know, let me check. I think I've solved that.
And she's like, well, you know, my friend out there, he plays for that team. And I was like,
you're
cool.
Seriously trying to catfish me.
Yeah, she's like, cool. I was just like, okay. She's like, you know, you could just let us store some stuff in there just for a couple days until we get our, you know, shit together. And I was like, yeah, no, I can't do that. She's like, she's
oh my God,
egging me on. And like, I'm like, I know what you're getting at. Like, I'm not gay. I'm not going to give you free storage.
That's retarded. What
for like a gay blowjob or something.
Why would she like?
Like, yeah. I was like, no.
I mean, I wouldn't do it either way, but at least make it appealing. Tell me that's your hot friend that's like Cindy coming or something.
Yeah.
Or,
she's real hot. What's your type? Redheads? Oh, yeah, she's redhead.
What is she, a black haired? Oh, I'm down for that. Brunette? Okay. Like, don't be trying to catfish a straight man with a gay man. That's not like.
I just thought it was funny. I was like, "Yep, I'm sure."
Just
like,
be lucky he didn't.
But are you sure? Because like after I was like 100% like, yep, super straight, like aggressively heterosexual, and she's like, "Cause my friend here, he's gay." I was like, "Okay, doesn't
that's great?
Yeah, good for him." But
get the fuck out.
Yeah,
that doesn't change anything. Get the fuck out. In fact, no, this changes everything. Get the fuck out. Like, yeah. Not only will you not be able to store anything here, but you, even if you had the money for the regular prices, I wouldn't want you to store your stuff here for the fact that I'm going to see you again.
Yes. Anyway, we've been at this for quite a bit now.
I think about an hour.
Yeah, about an hour. So we're going to have to close down. Sorry we have to shut down on such a strange note. But if you want to check us out, you can find us on Instagram at CSS Studios or on Facebook at Color in the Ship of Sound Studios. Of course, here at our YouTube page, Color in the Shape of Sound Studios. Troy, you want to give yourself a shout out?
Yeah, so I'm Troy Micheals again, and I'm recording an acoustic album. I don't know if it's going to be full length or an EP, but one of the two. And that's in the works at the moment. I'm also doing a full length album, which
will it be on vinyl?
I would love it. I would love for it to be on vinyl.
I love anything on vinyl.
But of course,
it could be freaking Fred Durst's solo album. If it was on vinyl, it'd be big.
It could be straight up like actually Cheeseburgers in Paradise, things like that, and it'll still sound good. But no, I'm gonna have an acoustic album out soon. I'm gonna work on that, and the full album I'm gonna have The Color of the Sound of the Studio. How do you say it?
Color in the Shape of Sound.
Color in the Shape of Sound Studios to help me out with the drums, because I don't know what the heck I'm doing. And what is this, a lug nugget? What is it,
no,
a drum
that's
head?
A cymbal, Troy.
Oh, yeah. So
that's a kick pedal.
Yeah, so I have no idea what even this is. Is this even a thing? What do you do with this? It's a stick.
Yeah, that's a drumstick. That's what you play with.
Oh.
It's essentially a drummer's pick, but, you know.
It's a big pick.
That's a drum key. That's how you tune it.
Ah, that's what it is.
Yeah, you were mentioning that you're trying to set up a tour.
I'm trying to set up a tour. Exciting. Nothing set in stone yet, but if everything goes good, it's going to be probably the first or second week of August. God damn, I can't talk today. And hopefully we're going to do a local tour. It's going to be from San Antonio to Austin to Dallas, Houston, Corpus, etc.
Yeah.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
More stuff later on.
And do you have a social media or anything? You just have personal stuff?
I have a Facebook. I don't have a website yet.
Me neither.
It's okay. Yeah, it's okay. We'll get through this. I'm gonna hit the ground running and get the ball rolling soon. So keep your eyes open and look out for.
Is your Facebook just your name or?
Yeah, well, I have my actual music page on there, although there's nothing on it except for just some photos. I plan to add some music once it's finally mastered and
perfect. I wouldn't put your full songs in there because people just steal them.
But, yeah. I probably have a music video, or at least like.
Okay, yeah, music video, that might be kind
of
cool, yeah.
Something to kind of. Of course, I'd want to like post stuff like, hey, by the way, we got merchandise, and hey, there's a show coming on this day, and probably have some live feeds of maybe me, some of people I work with, you know, having fun, B roll, etc.
Yeah, for sure. That'd be cool. So where can they find you then? What do they look up?
So you would just look up Troy Micheals, and that's spelled with E-A, not A-E, like everybody spells it.
Yeah.
I already have some stuff on, you just look up Google, and you'll just find it.
Okay, cool.
But I will have some more updates, and once I finally finish some music to release, that's the first thing you'll see.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I'm gonna release it everywhere and anywhere once it's out, so it'll be pretty hard to not find it.
Yeah.
So
I suggest when you release it, looking at DistroKid. It's $20 a year. You know what? Tell you about this later. They sponsor a bunch of YouTubers. I don't want to give them stuff if they're not paying me. So
no, you're right. You're right. And I also want to talk to you guys about PR and promo and stuff.
Yeah, because
there's
sure.
You know.
Yeah.
Good stuff there.
But if you want to find me, Jonah Gibson, on my personal Instagram, you can find me at. I'm ashamed of this. But poop mid. It's POOP_MID. That's my Instagram tag. Kevin, you want to be anonymous again, or you want?
Yeah, my feed is literally just pictures of
my wife and my car.
Wife, my car, and my ear stretching journey. That's really all it is.
Mine's cats.
It's just cats.
Lots and lots of cats.
You know what? Ryan Adams has a lot of cats on his, and he's
lots of cats.
He's a good guy. All right. Well, thanks for listening, and check out our channel for more local artists. And we'll see you next week. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.
Say bye, Kevin.
Bye bye, Butters.
Bye.
Bye.
Auf Wiedersehen!
So.
And I'm sleep deprived again. Yeah. Or in a podcast.
Yeah,
so,
sleep deprived clubbed.
Yeah, I'll probably be everywhere. But whatever.
Alright, so how'd you get your start on music? How did you. Where. What got you to where you are now?
That's a big question.
Yeah.
Where do I even begin? I'll start at 10 years old, because that's convenient, and that's when I started playing guitar. I came back to San Antonio after traveling for God knows how long, and I started living with my grandparents. They took me away from the foster system, because I was in another state, and that whole thing was crazy, but my grandpa bought me a Hohner acoustic guitar, which was awesome, but when I was a kid, I didn't think it was awesome. I just thought, okay, just a big wooden piece of junk. So after, like, this is going to sound real dark, but after a few months, my dad passed away. I met him, and I was like, well, I wasn't impressed. And then my grandpa passed away, and I thought, well, I better learn guitar, because he did want me to learn guitar, and I feel kind of like a douchebag not doing that. So I learned to play guitar. I was put in mariachi, for one, in middle school, and I learned how to play the guitar through very Mexican chords. Very, very Mexican songs.
That's kind of a inspirational, cool story that, like, you kind of learned for, like, your grandfather, and then now it came to be something that you super love and that your life is about. That's really cool.
It's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
I never thought I'd do that.
It's weird how things work out, right? Like, you know, like you said, when you're younger, you were kind of like, lame. Now it's kind of your life, you know.
It's
interesting.
I'm not gonna lie. When I first saw the Hohner guitar, I just thought, you know, damn, why couldn't it be like a video game or something?
Man, it couldn't be a Nintendo 64.
I was the same way when I was a kid and got my first guitar. I was like, oh, Liz bites.
To be honest, I was kind of like that. I wanted to play drums because my sister's boyfriend at the time played drums. I thought that was cool, and. But my mom wanted me to play guitar because my great-grandpa did, and that was, like, a special thing to her and stuff. And she bought me a guitar, and I liked it, and I thought it was cool, but, like, I wanted to play drums, so I kind of pushed it off. And, like, I guess I just thought it was going to be, like, this is going to be hard, like, and I want to play drums. I don't, like, I want, like, learning drums and learning guitar are both going to be hard. I don't want to start on guitar and then have to learn another hard thing. So I was like not really interested in it, but now I play both. So
I'm just imagining like the 10-year-old you or the 12-year-old, whatever, the little you.
I was in like sixth grade.
They're just like, here you go, like here's your first guitar, and you're like, yeah, you're trying to be excited, you're trying to act excited, but you're like, this is crazy.
Thanks, Mom.
So this is a nice guitar, but you know, I mean, I've seen some drums. This is nice, but you know, I've seen some of those drums and
some of those drum nice things.
Yeah, those little things. They're called drums. Drum things. You pull up Scott Pilgrim.
Yeah.
Drum yeah thingies, and that's funny.
Well, Kevin, you're the list master. What's going on here? Your wife made it.
I know she made it. That doesn't mean I can read. We're doing the welcome.
We did that. Welcome. Welcome, welcome to CSS welcome Studios.
Thank you.
You know, it's me, then it's CSSSS.
Yeah, we shot a video a while back reviewing a mic, and then Kevin's like, welcome to CSSSSS. Oh,
and
no.
And then I faded out. Yeah.
And he goes,
way too long. Shape up,
sound studio. Okay, CSS Studios. Yeah. He freaking works here, and he doesn't know the name of it. But that's my bad. I made the name way too long. It's not a marketable name. It's Color in the Shape of Sound Studios. Too much.
Well, I mean, it's nice when you have like a following. Like when you finally at that point where everybody knows you, it's like Color in the Sound Studios. It's like, oh, you know.
Yeah. But now we're not. We're not there right now. We have like 25 subscribers.
But you can be.
But it's also kind of hard too when I want to reach out to metal bands. It's like, it's Color in the Shape of Sound.
Yeah, like, wow, that sounds.
Hey guys, you sound pretty heavy. So that's a nice heavy sound you got there. Yeah. How would you like to come to my studio and make some really hard stuff?
All right, man. Color in the Shape of Sound.
What kind of studio you guys got?
Well, see, we got a Color in the Shape of Sound.
Color in the what?
Color in the Shape of Sound.
Somehow a metalhead like hooked up with a pop punk kid.
Yeah. Like we were talking about that earlier.
I picture Nathan Explosion just like, you're trying to pitch it to him, and he's like,
I don't think that I want to go to that studio. In fact, I want to punch the faces of everybody who works at that studio just because you told me. Like,
yeah. But,
Where are you from?
Where am I from? That's a big question, too.
Oh, wow. Here we go. That's good. We like to talk. That's what this show's about. It's literally a talk show.
Well, I was born here. Not here. I was born
right here in Color in the Shape of Sound Studios.
On this.
Yeah.
I was born right on this dance floor. It was ugly. There was the umbilical cord. It was. Yeah, I was squirming around like a fish. It was just everybody. that's how they wrote that.
That's where they got that name from.
Yeah, they got was it a band name?
It's a band name.
And ironically, the singer of the Blood of the on the dance floor was there. I was like, that's my name. But no, that's not how. But in all seriousness, though, I was born in San Antonio to a very, very Germanic, durable, weird-ass mom, and I had a total of four sisters on her side, different dads, and we had a stepfather, lived here for like the first 7 years of my life, probably the first 12 of my sisters, my oldest sister. I won't say the names because I'll just keep it, you know, very. Anyways.
Yeah.
So, I feel you. We went to Colorado. So that was a nice little trip, 980 miles. And we essentially just moved around to a lot of different cities. I hardly was ever in school. I don't even remember being in school. Like, I vaguely remember walking home from like a institution for learning, higher learning for kids.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like it's a fancy way of saying elementary school. But yeah. I vaguely remember doing that for a couple times, and then CEPS got involved, and DHS, which is Department of Human Services, they got involved too because it was supposedly inhumane how we were, or not inhumane, but like it wasn't the conditions weren't for children, so.
Mm-hmm.
We were taken and brought to social services where I stayed for about a year and a half by myself. And I was the youngest kid in the home, so everybody else was 12 and older. So, you know.
Okay.
And then my grandparents found out where I was at. And my dad did, but he didn't want to. He was doing his thing. So my grandpa and my grandma go to Colorado and pretty much talk to the courts, do the background check, and I come back with them, you know, in a month's time around December of 2000. No, 99. December 1999, and then it came 2000. When I got, you get the picture.
How old are you now?
I'm 26.
Okay, man, I'm the baby here again.
I'm an old one.
Okay, I'm 22, and he's 20. He'll be 28 tomorrow.
28.
Happy birthday, Kevin.
Thank
you. Okay, sorry.
Happy
go ahead.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday. alcohol. anyways, I shouldn't be joking about alcohol. But it's good for you. So I come back, and my grandpa is like the wisest. It's sad because I didn't know him that well. I only knew him for a few months, if that. I remember, like he would tell me some weird, really cool lessons that you can't like teach somebody how to say those lessons like that. Like this one time, my grandma was out doing errands, and he was like, "Hey Troy, you want to go in the backyard and make holes?" And I was like, "Yeah." So we get up and we go in the backyard, and he hands me this like stick. I think it's a shovel, but he just hands me one end of something. Yeah. I take it and I'm about to do it, and I flip it, and then I see it's a mop, and I'm like, and I'm processing this. My brain doesn't know how to interpret this. I'm like, how does he want me to? I'm seriously thinking about how he wants me to make holes in the mop. Like, is this some new type of like method of teaching kids or something? Like, I don't understand. And then he starts laughing like the love guru or the old man, and he's like, and then he just tells me like, Troy, you gotta use your eyes. You know, somebody can give you $5 and say, hey, here's the 50. Oh, you can just take it, and you know, you're out $45. And I'm like, wow, that's some serious, you know.
Yeah, so that's kind of cool. That's a good story, man. That's cool.
Yeah.
What happened? What
after that?
Yeah.
I stayed in San Antonio for most of that time up till 18, but I did go to Florida for a little bit, and I did go back to Colorado when I got older, and I started getting more into music. I met this guy Brad Bach, who was he had a full time job as like a insurance something, but he also like would manage artist, although that wouldn't really pay the bills, that would still fulfill some part of his life. And the artists that he would manage were initially they just needed like recording time and promo and maybe just basic stuff that you know an artist needs to get off the ground. And the artists themselves had, you know, full lives, and they were, you know, they progressed, and he was just kind of like there to record them. It was basically like a studio. It's
similar to what we're doing.
Yeah, similar like that. And he would just help them along, and he would keep track of them too. Like they would keep in touch. It wasn't like a dead like, all right, I finished your album, bye. Like,
get
it
out
was,
of here.
Yeah. It was a very like hey, how's it going?
It becomes a friendship type of thing. Yeah.
Yeah, and they
that's how we are here. Like all of the people we've recorded and all the artists we still keep in contact with, and whenever they you know, have new stuff coming out, we always promote it on our Facebook and stuff like that. And
yeah.
Try to keep in touch.
So that's really awesome. And Brad introduced me to Alan, who had like he owned the studio, and I basically was just a paid artist. I would help to like let's say vocalists came in and they had lyrics but they didn't have music. And surprisingly enough, you get a lot of those. And you would write. Well, I would write, you know, like riffs to it. I would write music, whether it be guitar, maybe a little ukulele.
Just like a studio guitar player. Yeah.
Whatever it was.
Sessions, or even just,
you know, stuff like that. Like
we'd
make up. was it too loud for the mic? No, we're good. But you know, I would create stuff for vocalists or artists, and you know, that was kind of my thing, and I would be paid per song or if like a band came in and like they obviously had the music, so I didn't need to do anything. I would just help out with like running the lines, making sure that everything was connected okay. I would do some office work too, like whenever we check inventory, because they did do like merchandise and CDs. They'd keep track everything that they had produced. They would always have like a UPC code. You know, they would just check how much stock came in, how much stock went out, you know, how many units were sold. Units is like CDs and stuff. I learned a lot of stuff through them.
Business work type of thing.
And it sucked because I hated every minute of it. But
really?
It did me good, though. It was so boring and annoying.
Was that kind of your first introduction to that real music business scene?
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, before I didn't know, I was like, I want to be an artist. And then I learned all this, and I'm like, damn, this sucks.
This is a real job. This isn't just playing music, yeah. There's a lot behind it, you know?
A lot of people don't realize that either.
Yeah, that's true. Especially when we have like a lot of people come into the studio. Mm-hmm. They don't realize, they're like, why am I paying so much money for this when we're a lot cheaper than a lot of other studios? And like, they're allowed to use any of our gear or, you know, any amps or what. And like, we're like, they're like, well, why pay you by the hour? Well, like, don't have your, you know, your shit together and you're, you know, wasting our time, then, you know, doing $100 a song can end up really putting us back, you know, when we could have other bands coming in and stuff, you know.
Brad had a saying, and I still think that's true to this day. Like, I'm also working on a movie project. Not me, but like, I'm my friend started this movie project, and it's called, I can't say the name of it, disclosure. But he wanted me to be the program director, which pretty much means I have to manage everybody's jobs. And,
yeah.
You know, and I respect everyone's time. I don't want to be saying things twice because that just wastes my time, wastes your time, etc.
Yeah.
And Brad would always say, for like, you don't want to waste people's time. Mm-hmm. So whether you're an engineer or you're an artist or you're a lawyer or you're whoever you are, mm-hmm. When you're coming to an establishment, like an artist coming to a label, or I'm sorry, a studio, and you're expecting to record your album, your single, whatever it is,
mm-hmm.
you know, you should have your stuff in line. You should understand that your time, like you guys as engineers, you have a lot on your plate. You have to manage your schedule. You have to make sure that the right, you know, the right edits went to the right pieces of music.
Exactly.
And that you can afford to do these things for artists. And these artists have to understand that the more time they spend in your studios, the more time that Yes, exactly. Time is money. And you need to, I want to respect everybody's time as they should respect mine.
What about something we usually get into on these podcasts are gear. Mm. Like I was telling you earlier, Kevin and I are kind of gear whores, and we're a little bit.
Especially if you look at the drum stuff.
Yeah,
I know.
That's Kevin's wall. That's Jeremy's wall.
In case you guys don't know, there's a big wall just filled with drums, just from top to bottom.
We're actually planning on doing a studio tour here pretty soon. I'm waiting on picking up a couple patch bays to put in the tracking room, and then I want to do a studio tour. Because all people really see in the podcast are kind of just the drums and a little bit of the back wall and the sides and stuff.
Yeah.
There are a couple pieces of gear over there, though, that I'm not allowed to touch.
Yeah. Kevin is a heavy hitter.
Let me guess. It's the tom. I mean, not the tom. The snare and a Zildjian.
Well, it's certain cymbals. It's actually a Sabian cymbal.
Sabian, okay.
Anything that is pretty much not these pitch blacks. These black cymbals.
Yeah.
Are like super heavy-duty metal cymbals.
Yeah.
Kevin's a dick. He breaks all my shit.
No. Oh, see. Thing. If you look at the set, I have a 22-inch ride. This is my old minus. There's a snare over there that I actually use that's not on the right now. I use that.
Yeah. We have a special head just for Kevin that has three layers on it.
How hard do you hit that thing? Like,
I'll show you after the podcast.
Just for later.
I play a 22-inch heavy ride, a 22-inch crash ride, or an 18-inch crash ride, and then I have a 20-inch ride over there
that he uses for a crash.
That he uses a crash. And then way in the back, there's a little like 16-inch fast.
I didn't
crash.
Even know you could use a ride for a crash. It's so like, how do you even?
I play thick sticks as well.
Yeah,
do you break your sticks every time you play? Like, bam.
He's
a new one.
He's taken a lot of time and effort finding sticks that work for him. He's found two sets. The one that we both use are the. Do you know who Travis Barker is?
I know who Travis Park. I mean, I know I've heard of him.
He's a drummer for Blink-182, and he does all kinds of side projects. But he has a pro stick that is like a freaking tree trunk, and it's actually based off of a marching snare.
Oh my god!
Yeah, that's, you can see Travis these.
these are fine, but
these are my main sticks.
Those are Kevin's sticks. Yeah, he just. God.
We'll see. Here. The thing is. I used to play metal and punk, and I was playing with guys that would bring in Marshall stacks.
Yeah.
So I've got to...
He's got to keep
up. I got really used to having to compete with guitarists.
And they didn't mic the drums because Kevin was a punk that played in crappy venues and stuff.
Yeah, so...
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah, I was lucky. Like, mainly the only thing that I ever get kicked or mic'd was like a kick.
So, yeah.
Yeah, I'm... Those are my behemoths. I actually own a pair that I speed train with that are even thicker, but I don't bring them here.
I don't now, let him bring thick here. Are you talking? Are you talking about like?
Have you ever seen them? Okay, well, here, basically, I have a set that's about that big.
Okay,
it's like a quarter.
All right. Yeah, pretty big.
That's probably really loud on mics. Like
a 3/4-inch stick or something. It's a Mario
wow.
Stick.
Yeah, it's.
There's still some. There's still some room there. If that's a quarter's length.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. He's not allowed to bring. He doesn't even. I don't let him step foot in the studio with the sticks.
Yeah. And on top of that, they're a aluminum grip.
They're already thick. Shot. Are you trying to kill the drums? Or?
Yes. That's what I'm telling you. I had to give him.
Heavy,
a,
so.
Okay. I had to get him a snare head that is freaking 3 layers thick to just don't so he doesn't put a hole in or soup bowl him out.
Yeah.
See, we were spending so much on heads.
Do you know anything about drum heads or drum tech stuff?
You know what? I wish I could answer that and say yes, but I'm just going to be honest and say no.
Put it this way. It sounds like you've hung out in studios.
Yeah.
You know bass drum heads are typically pretty thick.
Yeah.
That's how thick my toms are.
What?
Yeah.
No!
I use Aquarian Force Tins, and they're
pretty thick.
How do you even get sound out of that? Like, it doesn't just, like, how do you not get up? Or... Because
he hits so hard.
I can only imagine it's like...
Yeah. We'll show you after the podcast.
This is the ADHD kicking in.
Yeah.
We need to focus here. Okay.
But yeah, no, we didn't... Did we even talk about your gear? I said, man, so what kind of gear are you using?
We talked about and how Kevin's we're gear like, horse.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, well...
Yeah, what's your main acoustic setup? What kind of guitar are you using?
So,
is that you're playing today? Or?
Yeah, currently I'm playing a Mitchell... But I have been known to play Alvarez's, Yamaha's.
I got an Alvarez inside the house.
Oh, man. I love Alvarez's. Yeah. I gave mine away. Not gave it. I sold it because back then, weed's a hell of a drug.
Yeah. Okay. You know, you can say it. It doesn't matter.
Okay, well. Back then, not now, but back then, weed was a hell of a drug. And I had to let it go. But... Nowadays, I play Mitchells. I'm looking into getting a new Yamaha. I'm still open for suggestions for acoustic guitars.
Ibanez put out... What are you doing, Kevin?
Eastman?
Yeah, that's what you're using.
I had Washburns! Oh, I had Washburn. Yeah, I forgot about that.
I actually have... It's at home. It's like... It's my baby. I don't let anyone play it unless it's like...
Yeah.
Because you told me that I don't want to play the guitar because I want to keep it pure.
It's under you. But it's a there's a guitar boutique in San Antonio called Redbone, and they sell Eastman guitars. It's, I think the only
Wait
shop
a minute.
I know of
is that. Hang on, did the guy? Is it near downtown? And
it's on Broadway. It's got Beatles memorabilia everywhere.
Yeah, it has like, you know, like the Abbey Road?
Yeah.
It's got like that and out front.
Okay, so that's not the same place. I'm thinking of another place that I forget what it's called, but the guy that owns that works at Sam Ash, or he worked at Sam Ash.
Yeah.
And he had bought a place that was close to like going down, like the Blue Star.
Yeah,
studios.
Yeah, I know what that is.
Going down that street, and then like it steers off in like two ways, and
okay, yeah.
I think you take the... No, you go left. You go left, and you keep going down the street, and then you see, like, there's a fish restaurant thing, and then there's, like, these apartment complexes, and...
Is that their old shop? Because they just sold one of them.
No, they had a shop in the quarry, and their new shop is probably a mile south of 410 on Broadway.
Okay.
But, no...
You passed it going to Guitar Center, coming from downtown, right?
Well, they moved locations, but... Uh-oh. They, No, I play in Eastman, and it's a... People think kind of badly because it's a Chinese-made guitars. However, though, they're like it's a small like boutique company that's been around for over 100 years.
Well, if their quality is good, then it shouldn't matter where
they're
from.
Yeah,
a lot of people hear that though, and they're like, "Oh, China, like, you know, Chinese squires."
They're idiots. Ignorant people will say whatever.
Like, this is a $600 just straight acoustic, and throw a set of elixirs on that thing.
Yeah, it sounds great, and the action is close to an electric. It really is a great guitar.
Oh my god, wait! You need to write this down because I'm gonna look at that guitar.
Yeah, yeah. It's
I've been looking for something because that's a nice guitar. Don't get me wrong, just the strings are super old. Yeah, and I need to get a new.
Yeah, that Fender, that's a cheap guitar. That's my a Tim Armstrong guitar.
It's like a $300 acoustic.
It's like $500, I think.
No, it's maybe over three.
I think I got it for
if
500.
If it's a Fender, I believe five. It could be like $499 or something.
I think you can look it up. When I got it, I'm pretty sure it was like 500. But it's more of a like fast strumming guitar type of thing, and like you could do like a Johnny Cash type of thing, but it's not really playing real fast and stuff. Yeah.
$350.
Okay.
Okay.
See, my Eastman, I play a lot of like fast, like folk stuff on it. That's
yeah.
It's like my favorite. Yeah, like I play Eastman AC222, and it's a definitely bigger body than the Hellcat, but it's got like a nice.
It's thinner than my Johnson though, right? Or is it about the same?
Basically, are you talking about that thin one, the already thin one that you showed me?
No.
Okay, I was like,
No.
This guitar though, like, it's an acoustic. If it's just you playing, it's kind of like a Martin in a sense, where it's just got a nice full.
It's really warm. It's great.
Like, it's good if it's just a single person.
I used to have a Martin too, and I forgot about that.
I am one of the only people, but I'm not a Martin fan. Am I gonna get shot right now?
No, I liked it. Yeah. I really miss my Martin.
I'm a big Taylor guy. I love Taylors. See.
Okay, here. To me, this is exactly where I stand on this. Taylor is great if you're playing in a band and you need that little bit of cut
to get
through. Like, the Curly Wolf, he's endorsed by Taylor. Yeah. And the Taylor sounds really good with him. Mm-hmm. But somebody like him, Troy, right?
Yeah, Troy. Sorry. Yeah. No, you're good. I need to ask you guys his names, too.
Johnny, Kevin.
So, but like, for what Troy does, I think a Martin would go better.
Yeah,
especially with how his voice is.
Yeah,
I love my Martin when I had it.
Would go better. And they have a sick Martin SMS right now.
Really?
It's a black body with an ebony neck.
I saw one at Guitar Center,
I've actually seen that one, too. I haven't been to SMS since, like, 3 months. No, not even. It was, like, 2 months ago. But I've seen that guitar, though.
I think I saw that at Guitar Center. They have one now, too.
No, I haven't seen it in Guitar Center.
No. I saw maybe a.
But then again, I didn't go. You might if you, did you see it in the booth on the right, not the left one, but like the.
No, I saw on the left where all the nice, really expensive guitars are.
Okay, I didn't pay attention.
Sorry, I won't go into Guitar Center.
He doesn't. No. Yeah, he doesn't do that anymore.
I go to Sam Ash, but that's because I got buddies that work in the drum department. So.
Gotcha.
Shout out to Skippy and.
Drumbo,
yeah. Our other buddy who also works here, Jeremy Zapatu, I was telling his album's coming out. Yeah. Shout out to Jeremy's album coming out in 2 months. But anyway, we work downtown at First Baptist Church doing sound and stuff. But we'll have these weird work schedules where we'll have like 2 hours off in the middle of the day. So we'll just go hang out at Sam Ash and Guitar Center or like pawn shops and stuff and just look at gear. We're down there all the time. When I met you, what we were doing. We were on break.
Oh, man. Yeah. It sounds like an awesome job. Like, you guys just...
It's all right. We do a lot of manual labor as well, though, which I didn't sign up for, but it is what it is.
Hey, your take care of your body. Is not like what I got to do, though.
Okay, yeah, Kevin literally is a manual labor job. He picks up boxes and moves them.
Well, did you choose that, or did they say, well, this guy looks pretty burly. Hey, can you lift 50 pounds over your head?
I prefer... I can't sit in an office.
Yeah.
I'm too... Like, you can ask my wife. I can't even sit through a movie. Like, I don't know the last time I watched like a full movie and not gotten up.
Yeah.
I just gotta move. That's why drums are great for me.
Yeah.
You know what? I've noticed I haven't gone to the movies that much either. Like, I went to go see Logan. Not impressed, by the way.
Are you kidding me? I was just gonna say, so good. I was just telling you, you gotta see it.
Okay, not for me. Not. Oh, wait. You've seen it.
It's so good, guys.
It's so good.
It's so super ethereal.
I'm so ethereal.
It's so good.
I'm ethereal.
Are you sure, Al Gore? I will slap you. Super ethereal.
Don't make me slap you.
I'm a, just as ethereal as Member Pig, okay?
Member Pig. I love
it's real. But yeah, no, I mean, I liked. Okay, so Logan was a good concept. I didn't like how at the very end, like,
Spoilers.
Oh, I can't do any.
Okay. You can. I said spoilers now, so spoilers.
Okay, so spoilers. Yeah. Logan dies. And fact check, he doesn't come back. He just straight up stays under a shit ton of rocks, and like the girl has some sense of respect at the end of the movie when he finally dies. That's what gets me is like the whole movie, she hates his ass. She's like, you're dead?
Okay, I can respect
that.
Yeah, every fight.
And then she kind of gains a little bit of trust when like the fake Logan's trying to kill everybody. He's like, no, and he's like, you know.
Yeah.
But then that whole goes out the window because he's like, I'm leaving. And she's like, well, fuck you too then.
Yeah.
In Spanish. Yeah.
Even though she can speak English, she's like, you speak English?
Yeah, what? And that gets me too. She speaks English and Spanish, but she chooses to only speak Spanish for like 3/4 of the movie. And then she finally says, you know you're going to die, right? Like, and then you're like, she can talk?
Bitch, please.
Yeah.
I did like it though. I was really impressed. I'm impressed with 2016 and 17 movies altogether. I don't know if
I will say that too.
Are you a Star Wars fan?
Yeah.
Okay, because Rogue One and The Force Awakens.
Oh my god, guys, let me show you about Star Wars right now. It's so exciting.
You know what, Kevin?
That's so amazing.
This podcast got its start because we wanted to do a nerd podcast.
Oh.
So it turned into this just because I have
I've got to ask, what was this? Like, what was the. Okay, what was the first vision
of this?
All of this?
Okay, well, what happened was, I told you my buddy and I work at that church, and we have a lot of time off, and a lot of BS kind of happens at that job.
Yeah.
And I don't want to get into anything, because I don't want to call anybody out or anything, but it's just there's a lot of negativity there, and we have a lot of like time off and stuff, which is weird because of church, but it happens, you know? And just to pass the time, and not to cope, like it's not like, they abuse us or anything, but we're just
sounds like they abuse you.
Just to keep morale high or whatever between the two of us, we just joke around constantly, and it's gotten real bad. Like we come up with these crazy scenarios, like what if this happened, and like it's gotten so bad. This guy that we work with, normal guy, never had a problem with him. He just works, you know, desk job, whatever. We came up with a scenario that he has a past life that he was a clown, and he just. His name is Boppo. We gave him an entire story, background, the year he was born. It's really bad. And
dude,
so we...
This sounds like D&D level. Like, you just create an entire alternative life for people. Like,
yes, that's what we do.
Dude, that's like when a Camino CEO sees somebody, like, pulled over on the side of the road with, like, the truck with, like, the hood popped up or something. I'll just start going off and it's like... I don't know what happened to the car. It just stopped working. I don't know why.
Yeah.
It just ain't running.
Damocles is every time we keep going to get oil change, you just keep saying, I'm going to change it myself.
Yeah.
Never go around to it.
This is your milestone puff. It'll be number 1,000.
That's not all today. That's since I...
I know. It's since you've had it.
No.
It's like a car.
No, not since I've had it. You can reset it.
Well, then it's your milestone either way.
Okay, here we go. One more
He's
puff.
Trying to be happy. Just let...
Be happy
don't ruin his moment. Let him keep it. He
okay, there
it.
You go. 1,000.
Like
were you keeping track of that this whole time?
It was entertaining.
Okay. No, but anyway.
Like I said, I'm tired and ADD.
Anyway, so we have this, like, just this so stupid stories. It gets to where it's not even funny. Like, it's funny to us just because we're coming up with these weird scenarios. But,
I can
like,
dig that.
If you're, you know, talking to somebody, like, listen to this awesome joke. This guy, he's a clown. Like, okay, that's not funny. But so we thought we would make a podcast called Two Guys That Are Not High. Now, we don't really smoke or anything, but, like it's so stupid. It just sounds like.
It sounds
These guys
like
gotta
high.
Be high.
It's not high.
Yeah, so we wanted to call it Two Guys That Are Not High.
You know what?
And you remember Fuel TV?
Yes. Yes, I remember Fuel TV.
They used to have this show called The Daily Habit.
Back before it was all MMA.
Yeah, before it was all MMA. They used to have skating and BMX and all that on it.
I remember that. Tony Hawk was like a big thing. Everybody was just like, oh my god.
They had that Daily Habit show, and they had the show was where they have bands come on. And they interview them, kind of, and they play a small set. So I was like, I want to do that. That's really cool.
Oh, why don't you do that?
Well, that's what this is. That's like, you know,
you're doing it right now.
You should do that. We are.
Okay. We got to talk about marketing after this.
Because
that's a bunch of, nobody needs to hear that.
Yeah, but.
And we both skate.
Yeah, we both grew up skating.
You
could
make a big thing out of it. Like, you don't even know how much content you have for people to, like, take in. And
yeah,
so.
that's what we're trying to really go for. And. It's also a really good way to get the studio's name out because, you know, you're going to go take this and share it because, like, hey, check out the set I did and a little bit about me. And they're going to check it out and thus checking out more local bands. So when they see our channel, they see us and they'll maybe subscribe to our channel or whatever. And then they'll say, oh, look at this other band they did. I'll check that out. It looks similar. And they're like, it'll turn other people onto the other bands. And also, you know, when someone, like we just did a band called 40% Dolomite, they have a pretty good following locally.
They are so good.
They are so good. Shout out to G. You're a boss, man. No, but, you know, maybe some of their fans will listen. They'll listen and they'll see your set and be like, oh, let me check this out. And then, you know, just kind of spreading marketing and promotion, really, you know. It's a win-win-win-win situation.
That definitely helps. Also, street teams are really awesome, too.
Okay, well,
I'm not going to... I'll talk to you guys after that, because there's some stuff that, like, you could just take this to a whole new level. But anyways... Yeah.
That's what we're going for. We like I said, we just started, like, maybe a year ago. We started doing... You're only, like, the fourth or fifth, like, artist we've had, so... We've had a couple guys, like engineers, come in and talk and stuff, but this is kind of, the whole podcast thing is really new. We're mostly, okay, we're at 32 minutes. We've got to wrap this up in a little bit. Anyway, sorry.
You're good.
A bunch of guys with ADD. from the wife in there. No, not my wife, Kevin's wife.
My wife.
My girl's not here. Anyway.
She keeps us on track.
Well, that's good.
Well, that's what you need a woman for.
I'm dating my next bandmate, Samantha.
No, but we're really just trying to promote ourselves really right now. That's why we're doing these. Like, you can come on for free and to promote yourself. And a lot of bands are, like, in high school still and stuff. They can't afford to do recordings. So if you want to, you don't have to, but you can buy. If you're a solo artist, it's 25. And if you're a full band, it's 50. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you got five guys in a band, 50 is not – that's not bad.
No, it's nothing. Know? That's less than –
10 bucks a piece. Yeah. You know?
But if you do gangster rap, it's 10 grand.
God damn it, gangster raps.
I haven't had any hip hop artists in here, but I'm not opposed to it. I'll mix it and stuff.
I'm actually trying to get one in. I actually tried getting one in. Yeah.
I've actually helped. Go ahead.
I've actually surprised people because I'm like, I'll introduce myself. I'm like, hey, I'm Kevin Mark. I work at a local recording studio. But it'll throw them off because it's a show with like 10 people at it.
Yeah.
And they're like,
that's perfect though.
You get
exactly. Yeah.
Admissions.
Oh, whoa, wait, what?
They're like,
hey, you never know who you're gonna meet at a show, man.
Exactly. Yeah. That's I've always said trying, that. You know, dude, we'll go out and pass out business cards. They're just like when I saw you, I was like, oh, here, have a business card. You know.
Yeah, I still have it.
Yeah, I've just I saw you jamming and heard you were kind of barely singing and stuff. I was like, okay, that is pretty good. And we got talking about guitars and stuff. So it's just
they're. Business card Rocio made for me.
I saw him. His are coming out. I got those made maybe, I don't know, a few, like, maybe 5 months ago or so. And that's kind of how I started promoting and stuff. But,
earlier, but I forgot.
Oh, man, that's the worst. It's going to bother you for the rest of the day if you don't think of it.
Oh, no. Well, because, like, I want to talk about the Uber incident, but then there was something before that.
That's... The card's my wife designed.
That's the front.
That's the front of it.
That's cool.
There's a back. White on like a white, and then the back is a sound wave. She's nice. A graphic designer, so she makes lots of stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's kind of our unofficial graphic designer. She's, we have bands and stuff come in, and they need cover art or whatever, or any... Yeah. Maybe banner or something. We'll throw the work to her. I do a little bit. I did a cover art for my buddy's album that's coming out real soon, Jeremy's. And it took me like 2 days to make the front, back, and the CD. And like for Rocio, she could knock that in like 2 hours.
Right? You say 2 days, but how many hours was that?
I don't know. I was in here for like hours, like a long time. Like
1/6, less than 12?
Probably like 12 hours.
12? Damn.
Yeah.
Damn.
It is literally just like a picture with text on it.
You spent 12 hours on text?
Well, I mean, Did you at least
add color to it? Or?
Yes. And I had to figure out, like, I don't know anything about Photoshop. I have it.
That explains it.
Yeah.
It's dark white.
It took me the longest time to get, like the proport. I had to, like, look up the proportions, do a lot of research and everything. And, like, I had to figure out how to, like, get, like, the shape of the CD and the hole in the middle. That took me for, like, 2 hours. I could not find tutorials on it.
I picture you just sitting there like, okay, this shade of white needs to be eggshell, and this needs to be just like straight up vanilla white. And I swear to God, if it isn't vanilla white, then someone's going to be held accountable.
Yeah, it was pretty bad. But yeah, I've really been doing more... Well, my obviously main thing is the audio. I'm an audio engineer. Mm-hmm. Kevin and I both graduated from AEI, and that's our thing. But I've been branching out and doing videography, so trying that out.
Good.
I'll show you my girlfriend's channel. Shout out to Allie O'Brien. She has a channel if you like dance. Anyway, I'll show you some, you know, start of my videography career, I guess. Not really career, just it's more of a hobby, and I'm helping her out.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
You ever need a drummer too for any of your recordings? I'm a session drummer here.
Yeah.
I kind of do need a drummer.
He's your man. Look at him.
Oh, you know what?
Session dude.
I have. Oh man, I actually have like a few songs I wanted to add drums to, but I don't know. Just I never found a drummer to like do anything with, or even if I have to like re-record them, I never found anybody to like.
Well, he does everything from jazz to metal to like hip hop, like.
Big Bad
Voodoo
Daddy, the Bowling
Pursuit. Whoa, Black Betty, Bam, Lamb. Whoa, Black Betty.
Ambulance!
Yeah.
You see that video?
The agony scene.
Yeah.
Like,
what does the fox say? Yeah, I saw that video. I saw it when it was before it was famous.
I saw that before it was a meme.
I did, actually. I, like, because my friends, I have friends who work in, like, entertainment news. One of them lives near New York, and she works for Ithaca or something. And then I have another friend who works for Worldwide Metal News or something. It's a joke news, but like it's still entertainment. It's like alternative press, but not as big. It's maybe half the size.
Yeah.
And he sent me a video of it, and he was like, "Hey, check this out!" And it was that stupid song. I was like, "Do do 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 do." And I'm just like, "Yeah." And I'm listening to it, and I'm like, "What the fuck is this? Did you seriously make this as a joke and then send it to me?" He's like, "No, that's the actual.
that's an actual song
off of their album." And I'm like, "You're lying." And he's like, "No, it is."
But, that's funny. Okay, this has been really eating at me. Before, when we were setting up for the podcast, Troy was telling us he used to be an Uber driver.
I keep clicking this pin. Here, Kevin,
just take this. Just do it. Here.
Thank you.
He's got a fidget toy now.
I'm a drummer. I can't sit still, man.
Quit. Don't hit the freaking microphone with your hand. Jeez, a peek,
Kevin.
That's
cool. You got it?
Yes, Mother.
Troy, you used to be an Uber driver, and you had me on the edge of my seat. And I wanted to save it for the podcast, so let's hear it.
Oh, man. So I have some stories. I have some real shit that has happened in Uber. I won't disclose names because privacy. But I will say that... All right, so I picked up these two lawyers. This happened last year, sometime around, like, August. And I picked up these two lawyers.
It was the dude, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. So there's two really old, like, picture 5'4", really kind of, like, skinny Mexican-looking older guys. You know, they're lawyers, and they're
doing their suits and stuff.
Yeah, so they're going back home. Well, I drop off his friend, and while we're going to his place, because his house was, like, another 8 miles.
Yeah.
He started talking more, like, about what his job. He's like, "Oh yeah, I talk to children who have been in like bad situations." And I think, okay, that's a cool.
Because
I'm going for counseling, so
you know, can relate or whatever.
Yeah, I'm like, that's cool.
Yeah.
Now, what got me was it started getting a lot creepier in the conversation because he started asking me personal questions that.
He was trying to counsel you as your as his
Yes, that's what was creepy about it was he was giving the same tone that normally counselors or litigators do for kids, but like with me, and he asked me the same type of questions. Like in my head, I'm picturing him talking like this to kids and like how messed up it is and how do I report this guy? You know, like but
he pulls up a bear. He's like, "So where did she touch you?"
Yeah, like there's just creepy stuff. Like he'd say, "Oh, well, are you a virgin? This? Oh, you know." Or he just asked stuff like, "Have you ever been molested when you were a kid? I sense that this, and oh, you know, I mean, I heard that statistics say that kids who get molested by the same gender
become Uber drivers
or something." No. Or something really dumb and specific. And I'm like, the whole time I'm just like, I want to get to this guy's house and just
so
get
bad,
the fuck out.
Yeah.
And then he starts talking about how he's an exhibitionist and he likes people to watch him as he strips naked.
What?
And I'm telling you, this is the weirdest ride.
I could somehow get naked right now if that makes you feel more comfortable.
No, somehow, like, the conversation in those 8 miles, those 12 minutes, like, it was the longest conversation I'd ever had in 12 minutes because it felt like hours. It was like it would not end. I wanted it to just be over.
You're driving, you all get like, you hit every red light and get stuck in traffic.
Basically,
like,
no. And I could not, like, it was so long. And then by the end of the ride, here's the creepiest part. He's like, before we get to his house, like, it's about a minute or so.
Yeah.
Somehow he brings up daddy. He brings up like the dad thing. He's like, "Oh, you need a daddy? I can be your daddy. You want me to be your daddy? I will be your daddy." Like, he's
I will
saying,
never call you daddy.
Like, I shit you not. That is exact. He's just like, "Do you want me to be your daddy? I'll be your daddy. Yeah, I'll be your daddy. Do you want me to?" And then we get to his house, and then he's like, "Okay, well, I'm gonna go in my backyard, and I'm an exhibitionist again, and I'm gonna strip naked, and I'm gonna take a piss outside. You can come and watch me if you want." And I was like, "No, I'm good."
Oh, my phone's ringing. I gotta go.
Oh no, another notification. Oh, that's there's nothing on your phone. Yeah. Oh, it's that new app. It doesn't show anything. I have to click it or else. No, I didn't pull any. I was just like, "No, I'm good. I'm just gonna
trying to cut to, down on the public to, nudity."
Yeah, I have to get home because this. I just made up some bullshit. And he's like,
"Honestly, been like, you know what? Don't even pay me. Just get out."
It took it took some time. No, the app better.
Did he tip you? Or does it you?
No, no, he didn't. I was thinking about that. No,
he thought that your tip was him offering to, you know, you watch him pee.
Somehow that doesn't sound appealing. It just doesn't sound like I don't wake up one day and say, "I hope so. I hope I get to watch somebody pee outside as a tip." Because that's just
that's worth more than money. That, you know, I don't need to eat this week. I just want to see someone take a pee out back.
Seriously, like, it was the weirdest crap ever. And like, he gets out, and like, I one star that asshole, because, like, no. If I could have zero starred him, I would have, but they don't give you that option.
Yeah.
Literally, after that, I turned off the app, I went straight home. And have you ever seen those movies where, like, the dude has the same straight face? He's just like, and like, he's going home in the car, and then it shows him in the shower, and then it shows him like,
it's just like, it's the same thing,
the same face, but like, he's just doing different actions. He's just like trying to process, like,
what happened,
like,
to
you're
me?
Trying to process, like, oh my god, did that actually, like, you have like pre-PTSD symptoms, and you're just like trying to cope, your brain's coping with it, like, oh my god, what happened,
that happened
for the whole day, that night, the next day, and then after, like, the morning, I woke up and I was like,
did that guy really?
Holy shit, I need to tell my friend. I call Ed, and I'm like, "Hey, man, I got some shit to tell you that you're going to want to hear. Because this, like, just get the fuck over here. I got to tell you something." And then basically, I just started telling my friends about it. And
then you tried to start a podcast, but your friend denied the world from that story. But I'm here with CSS Studios to give the world this story.
The world needs to know.
Yes.
The world must know how many licks does it take to get to the center of a titty pop.
Yeah. All
right. So that was one story.
I'm wildly content with this hand spinner.
I told you, Kevin, I bought this little, for
me
people
too.
Listening.
It's actually very pleasing to, like, watch.
You, yeah, he, it's like, they have these fidget toys for people listening. It's just like skateboard bearings, three of them out in kind of a star shape, and then one in the middle, and you just spin it, and it's oddly satisfying.
It's
the world.
Yeah. Just go ahead, Troy. Just try it out. Just.
Oh my god.
Now do this a little bit. Kind of go back and forth. You get like a weird, like.
Gyroscope.
Yeah.
Oh, this is more. This is really fulfilling. How much was this?
Okay, it was an impulse purchase.
This is a
sore
subject for him.
It was an impulse purchase. I was at
my bigger discount.
No, I didn't steal it. I was at the vape shop and they had them. And I was like, "I'll buy one," and it was $12. I spent $12 on a piece of plastic and three skateboard bearings.
Oh, you can go on Amazon and get that for $1.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah, you can buy one for like $1, and you can get like a little bit better one for like $3. But you know what? Whatever. I'll go out to a restaurant, stuff my girlfriend puts in her purse, and when I'm like at the table, like, "Oh, ketchup or salt, pepper," I'll be messing with shit, and she just takes it and then hands it to me and goes, "Okay, there you go, babe." But yeah. That's
one hell of a story.
Yeah, that's crazy. But you know what the sad thing is?
Yeah.
I believe it, man. The world, like, for a while, I worked at a storage facility for a while, right when I got out of high school. And if you think about it, people that need storage are a lot of people that are moving or they're getting evicted or something, and they're kind of at the worst point in their life. And I just heard some crazy stories. I think the weirdest thing that ever happened to me was this chick and two guys came, and they had a U-Haul truck full of just their belongings,
dildos.
Yeah, it was full of dildos. No, they just whatever was their stuff, and they were trying to get storage, and they were, you know, asking me about prices and stuff, and I told them, and they're like, these prices are ridiculous. I need something better. Can you give me a better deal? And I was like, I just work here. I don't make the prices. This is what it is, you know? And then she was like, come on, just give me a deal or whatever. And I was like, I'm sorry, I can't. I just work here. And then so they went out, and they were standing outside the office, like outside, and they were just talking. And she, just the girl came in, and she goes, so are you by any chance gay? And I was like, no, not a fan of the sausage. Never played for the other team. And she,
I don't
like,
play that game, Missy.
And she was like, are you sure? And I was like,
Pretty sure.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, I've never had that desire. Nope, pretty sure. And she's like,
I don't know. Let me check.
No. Yeah.
I think I've solved that.
And she's like, well, you know, my friend out there, he plays for that team. And I was like,
you're cool. Seriously trying to catfish me.
Yeah. She's like, cool. I was just like, okay. And she's like, you know, you could just let us store some stuff in there just for a couple days until we get our, you know, shit together. And I was like, yeah, no, I can't do that. She's like, she's
oh my God,
egging me on. And I'm like, I know what you're getting at. Like, I'm not gay. I'm not going to give you free storage.
That's retarded. What
for like a gay blowjob or something.
Why would she like?
Like, yeah. I was like, no.
I mean, I wouldn't do it either way, but at least make it appealing. Tell me that it's your hot friend that's like Cindy coming or something.
Yeah.
Or...
she's real hot. What's your type? Redheads? Oh, yeah, she's redhead.
What is she, a black haired? I'm down for that. Brunette? Okay. Like, don't be trying to catfish a straight man with a gay man. That's not like.
I just thought it was funny. I was like, yes, I'm sure. And she's like,
lucky he didn't.
But are you sure? Because like after I was like 100% like, yep, super straight, like aggressively heterosexual. And she's like, because my friend here, he's gay. I was like, okay, doesn't.
That's great.
Yeah, good for him. But
get the fuck out.
Yeah.
That doesn't change anything. Get the fuck out. In fact, no, this changes everything. Get the fuck out. Like, yeah. Not only will you not be able to store anything here, but you, even if you had the money for the regular prices, I wouldn't want you to store your stuff here for the fact that I'm going to see you again.
Yes. Anyway, we've been at this for quite a bit now.
I think about an hour.
Yeah, about an hour. So we're going to have to close down. Sorry we have to shut down on such a strange note. But if you want to check us out, you can find us on Instagram at CSS Studios. Or on Facebook at Color in the Shape of Sound Studios. Of course, here at our YouTube page, Color in the Shape of Sound Studios. Troy, you want to give yourself a shout out?
Yeah, so I'm Troy Micheals again, and I'm recording an acoustic album. I don't know if it's going to be full length or an EP, but one of the two. And that's in the works at the moment. I'm also doing a full length album, which...
will it be on vinyl?
I would love it. I would love for it to be on vinyl.
Love anything on vinyl, yeah.
But of course you gotta.
It could be freaking Fred Durst solo album. If it was on vinyl, it'd be good.
It could be straight up like Cheeseburgers in Paradise. It could be that, and it'll still sound good. But no, I'm gonna have an acoustic album out soon. I'm gonna work on that, and the full album. I'm gonna have the Color of the Sound of the Studio. How do you say it?
Color in the Shape of Sound.
Color in the Shape of Sound Studios. Yeah. Help me out with the drums, because I don't know what the heck I'm doing, and what is this, a lug nugget? What is it?
No, that's head? A cymbal, Troy.
Oh, yeah. So,
that's a kick pedal.
Yeah, so I have no idea what even this is. Is this even a thing? What do you do with this? It's a stick.
Yeah, that's a drumstick. That's what you play with.
Oh.
It's essentially a drummer's pick, but, you know.
It's a big pick.
That's a drum key. That's how you tune it.
That's what it is.
Yeah, you and you were mentioning that you're trying to set up a tour.
I'm trying to set up
soon.
A tour.
Exciting.
Nothing set in stone yet, but if everything goes well, it's going to be probably the first to second week of August. God damn, I can't talk today. And hopefully we're going to do a local tour. It's going to be from San Antonio to Austin to Dallas, Houston, Corpus, etc.
Yeah.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
More stuff later on.
And do you have a social media or anything? You just have your personal stuff?
I have a Facebook. I don't have a website yet.
Me neither.
So okay. Yeah, it's okay. We'll get through this. I'm gonna hit the ground running and get the ball rolling soon. So keep your eyes open and
Is your Facebook just your name or?
Yeah, well, I have my actual music page on there, although there's nothing on it except for just some photos. I plan to add some music once it's finally mastered. And
perfect. I wouldn't put your full songs in there because people just steal them.
But I'd probably have a music video or at least like...
Okay, yeah, music video, that might be kind
of
cool, yeah.
Something to kind of... Of course, I'd want to like post stuff like, hey, by the way, we got merchandise, and hey, there's a show coming on this day, and probably have some live feeds of maybe me, some of people I work with, you know, having fun, B-roll, etc.
Yeah, for sure. That'd be cool. So where can they find you then? What do they look up?
So you would just look up Troy Micheals, and that's spelled with E-A, not A-E, like everybody spells it.
Yeah.
I already have some stuff on, you just look up Google, and you'll just find it.
Okay, cool.
But I will have some more updates, and once I finally finish some music to release, that's the first thing you'll see.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I'm going to release it everywhere and anywhere once it's out, so it'll be pretty hard to not find it.
Yeah.
So
I suggest when you release it, looking at DistroKid. It's $20 a year. You know what? Tell you about this later. They sponsor a bunch of YouTubers. I don't want to give them stuff if they're not paying me. So
No, you're right. I also want to talk to you guys about PR and promo and stuff.
Yeah, for
there's,
sure.
You know, good stuff there.
But if you want to find me, Johnny Gibson, on my personal Instagram, you can find me at... I'm ashamed of this... But poop mid. It's POOP_MID. That's my Instagram tag. Kevin, you want to be anonymous again? Or you want to...
Yeah, my feed is literally just pictures of...
My wife and my car.
Wife, my car, and my ear-stretching journey. That's all it is.
Mine's cats.
It's just cats.
Lots and lots of cats.
You know what? Ryan Adams has a lot of cats on his, and he's...
Lots of cats.
He's a good guy. All right, well, thanks for listening, and check out our channel for more local artists, and we'll see you next week. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.
Say bye, Kevin.
Bye-bye, Butters.
Bye.
Bye.
Auf Wiedersehen.